So yesterday we started discussing about different ways of traversing a binary tree. We compared the way linear data structures like linked lists, arrays, queue, as well as stacks are actually traversed. And we compared, sorry for the in between the switch, I mean switch from my end, my attention, because I needed to allow some people. So we started discussing about I mean actually we compared the way linear data structure like arrays, linked lists, stacks, and queues can be traversed. By traversal, I mentioned that traversal means the visiting and processing of the individual elements stored in a tree. So, in comparison to the linear data structure, we discussed about this hierarchical data structure that we started this discussing, started in this topics, which is a tree. So for tree, as we have mentioned, I will be considering two cases. One is visit and another is processing. So it might be a little bit confusing for you guys to understand why am I mentioning these two similar things in using two different keywords. One I'm mentioning as visit and another I'm mentioning as processing. So let me clear that out. So by visiting a node, I am mentioning or I am specifying for this binary tree, a node, say PTR, will be pointing to the node. So if this is the binary tree, then, and if this is the root, then if I set one pointer, say PTR equals to R, that is the root, then I am making another pointer here. So by setting this, I am mentioning that this root node or this node, say containing the value of A, is visited. Not my word, it's visited, not processed. So, as I've said, for this example, PTR equals to root will be visiting the root. And by processing, I am indicating that the content or the data that is stored in the node will be actually accessed. And by this access of a node, I am specifying it as the processing of a node. For this for this course topic, we will be considering the printing of the value as a processing. So to process the node, we'll be just printing the value or the data part that is stored in that pointer. Again, by visiting, so if I again draw that same tree, so if this is the root, and if I apply this operation, PTR equals to root, then a new pointer PTR will be pointing to the root node. And this is visiting. And by processing, what I will be meaning is I'll be printing the value that is stored in the node that is pointed to by the pointer PTR or the variable or the object of this PT node, PTR. All right. In the last class, we started about different ways a tree can be traversed. We mentioned that if I consider three letters to specify the different operations that can be happening in a node, specifically D, R, and L, where D is the, by D, I am considering that the node, the node is processed. That is, as I have said, the node, the data part that is stored in the node is getting printed. By that, I will be mentioning it as D. By R and L, respectively, I will be I'll be pointing out to the fact that the left pointer or the right pointer are left pointer and right pointer are visited. That means at some point, so by processing, if say PTR equals to root again, then by this D, I'll be considering, I'll be basically doing this printf the value of PTR data. I'm just writing the pseudo code here. I'm not writing the actual code. So printf PTR data, and by visit of the right, visit of the right subtree, I'll be kind of mentioning this as PTR equals to PTR write, and by visit of the left node, I'll be mentioning the operation or the corresponding C statement will be PTR equals to PTR left. Now one question to you. So consider again the same tree. Initially, there is only one pointer, that is root. So by this operation, what I am actually doing? Am I visiting the node or am I processing the node? Anyone?
I am visiting
the node. So the point is, to process a node, I first need to visit the node. So as you can see, PTR equals to root, and then only I can perform this operation, that printf in quote percent %d, if the stored thing is an integer, and then PTR data. So to process a node, we first need to visit it, and then only we'll be able to process the node or process the data stored in the node. All right. So as there are three options on this D, R, and L, we discussed that in basically six ways we can process the current node. So to process the current node, one option is whenever I am at a node, I'll be processing the node, then either I'll be visiting the left node and the right left subtree and the right subtree, or the left node and right node. And another is, again, I'll be processing the current data or current node, but I'll be visiting the right and left subtree in the other order, right? That is, initially, I mean, in the first example, in the first way that I have said is left then right, and in another option it will be first right then left. So for example, if this is the tree, considering say containing the value 1, 2, and 3, for this DRL, can you say what will be the way this nodes will be processed? And I mean,
first 1, then 3, then 2.
First 1, then 2, then 3, and for this?
1, 3, 2.
1, 3, 2. Perfect. And another way is process the current node in the middle. First, either visit and process the left or right subtree, then process the current node, and then visit and process the either the right subtree or the left subtree. So for the same tree, if I have the same data, same tree drawn here, 1, 2, 3. So it will be 2, 1, 3, right, left, then data, then right, left, then data, then right, and RDL will be 3, then 1, then 2. And the third way is I'll be visiting the data part, or the I'll be processing the current node at the end. So again, if I draw the same tree, 1, 2, 3, for this settings where I'll be visiting the left node before, left subtree or left node before the right node, it will be 2, 3, 1. And if I visit the right node, if I visit the right node before the left node, or right subtree before the left subtree, then it will be 3, 2, 1. Got it? All right. So again, I would like to again highlight this thing. By processing of a node, we will be referring to the just the printing of the data stored in that node. It can be some other operations based on your requirement, but for this discussion in this course, we'll be considering the processing of a node by just printing the value. Now, again, please help me to write it. So if the tree contains the root is, so basically the binary tree containing three values, A, B, and C in this manner, then what will be the order in which this A, B, C will be processed? Can you please tell one by one? DLR, what will be the order?
A, B, C.
DLR will be A, B, C. And DRL will be
ACB.
ACB. LDR will be
BAC.
And it will be CAB, right? For LRD, it will be BCA. And for RLD, it will be CBA. Everyone with me up to this? All right. So this was the actual order. But as you can see here, for these two, I am processing the current node at the beginning. For these two, I am processing the current node in the middle. And for these two, I am processing the current node at the end. So as there are three parts, if I mention it them as 1, 2, and 3 in a node, the possible options are either I'll be visiting and processing the first part, I'll be visiting and processing the second part, I'll be visiting and processing the third part. So based on this, we can club them together, or we can consider either of them for actually processing it. Of course, we can, I mean, as we can see, the output will be different, but generally DLR and DRL, so this is usually do not that much considered. Usually this order is considered. LRD, this one is considered. This one is less considered, I mean less popular on in terms of traversing a tree. And LRD is the more conventional way of traversing a tree, other than this, I mean in comparison to this RLD. But of course, we will be discussing one scenario where we'll be using this way of traversing the tree. So just wondering, can you remember where actually we have kind of done this way of processing? Can you remember where? First right, then the data, then the left. Actually, we have done this while printing the tree in the screen. As you may remember, so this was the screen. So this tree was getting printed as, in the first line it was C, then in the second line it was A, and in the third line it was B. So as you can understand that the screen, the processing of the pixels in a screen start from the very top left corner. You can consider this as not processing of the pixel, but you may consider the terminal or the command prompt in which you type some commands. So then, in those command prompts, as you may have seen, that everything starts from the beginning and it is starting from the top left. So after taking the cursor from here to here, it's usually not possible to go back from here to here. Theoretically, it's possible, and practically is also there are some operations on incurses and backslash as well. But usually, if I come to the next line, it's not possible or it's pretty hard for us to go back to the previous line in the screen. So here, the way we have printed, I actually collapsed the code because I'll be discussing that later on. But the way, as you may guess that, we were printing in this way. So basically, to print a tree in this way, we first need to access the rightmost node in the tree, and the rightmost node will be traversed by this traversal order. First right, then data, then left. First right, then data, then left. Of course, for a large tree as well, it will work. We'll be discussing this. All right. So as I have said, there are basically three broader ways of traversing the tree. LDR, where the data part or the data stored in the current node is processed in between visiting the left subtree and right subtree. This is called in-order traversal. For pre-order traversal, the data part in the current node is processed in the beginning, then the left subtree is visited and processed, then the right subtree is visited and processed. And for post-order traversal, the left subtree is visited and processed in the beginning, then the right subtree is visited and processed. Finally, the current node is processed. But still, one thing I'd like to highlight here as well. So the D part is the current node's data part, isn't it? So to visit the left subtree of the current node or the right subtree of the current node, we should be visiting this node, right? So in all these nodes, we can understand that we are visiting the nodes multiple times, but we are processing the nodes only once with this. Again, is it clear? Let me tell you once again. So considering this LDR, this is the tree, say. So the root is here. Now, first, so this node is already processed, right? Visited. As the pointer is pointing to as some pointer. So if I consider, say, P equals to R, so what I am doing is I am making another pointer P to point to the same root node of the tree. I am keeping this R intact because I do not want to change the tree. So that's why I am keeping this root as intact, and I do not want to change it. Yeah. So I have set another variable P. initialized with the value of r. That is, this p is also pointing to the root of the current node, current tree. Now, as I have issued this statement, that means I have already visited this. Now, for this statement, for this L thing, for visiting this left subtree, what I need to do is I need to make P equals to P left, isn't it? So for P left, so basically what I am doing is I am kind of removing this pointer and I'm pointing this left subtree of the node containing A with the same parameter, same variable P. Now this node is visited. Now I am, as there is no left subtree here, so I will be, again I will be going to the P equals to P left. So P left will be here, which is null. Then I'll be coming. So as you can see, up to this left part is traversed, because left part, as you can see, I'm facing one null pointer. So now what I'll be doing is, so when I'm applying this P equals to P left from here, this pointer is again removed. So the new P was this null, and P equals to P left, that is this P, the new P is a null. So this part is traversed or visited and processed. And as there is no node, it is actually not printing anything. Now, after processing this, again this P needs to come back to here. So then again I need to make this P to point to this B again. So now I will be processing the node, right? So I'll be processing the node by printing the value that is stored in the node, that is B. So as you can see, the P was set to here, then P was set to null, then P was again set to here. So as you can see, the P is set to this node containing B twice. So that means two times we have already visited the same node, but we are processing the node only once. Do you have any question up to this? All right. So let's try to draw the in-order traversal, or the way this tree will be traversed, the individual nodes will be traversed using an in-order traversal. So by in-order traversal, as I have said, the left subtree will be visited and processed first, then the current node will be processed, then the right subtree will be visited and processed. So traverse the left subtree, then process the root data, and then traverse the right subtree. Then what will be the order in which this tree will be processed, or the individual nodes will be processed? Can someone say? So initially the root is pointing to here. So what will be the order in which this tree is processed in order traversal? Anyone?
So three first
it will be three. Then why?
Because it will go to the left subtree before processing seven.
Correct. So basically we will be again applying this P equals to R. I'll be making this new pointer, then I'll be coming back to the left, so the new P will be here, and so as there is no tree, so the P will be here. And as it is null, so the traverse of the left subtree of this tree, the left subtree of this tree is completed. Then I need to traverse the root node, that is 3. So that's why 3 is getting processed, that is printed here. Then I need to go to the right. Then please go ahead.
Then 5 will be processed because it is a left child of 6.
Right. So the new P will be this one, and then the new P will be this one, and then as there is no left subtree here, P will be pointing to the null, then again will be coming back to here, and in that case the left subtree of this tree is processed. The left subtree is processed. Now we need to process the root data. That is, we will be printing the value of 5, and then the P will be pointing to here, right? And again it is a null, it is containing no value. Then P will be coming back to here, right? So yeah. For this tree, for this subtree where 6 is the root, the left subtree of this tree containing 6 and 5 is visited and processed. So now we need to, so traversal of the left subtree for this tree 6 and 5 is done. Now we need to process the root data. Then the root of this tree is 6. Then 6 will be getting printed or processed. Then again the right subtree, P will be pointing to the right subtree of this tree. Again it is null. So for this tree containing 6 and 5, the whole traversal of this node, of this subtree from this whole tree is completed. Now the P will be set back to here. From here we will be able to see that the left subtree, the root data as well as the right subtree, all are traversed, that is visited and processed. Now the P will be again set to the root node, right? Now from here, this is the whole tree. Yes, please go ahead.
Sir, while you are returning back to the root node, are you because you have to remember the address of the root node, because from the child node there is no address pointing to the root.
Very nice, good question. So how am I doing that?
Yeah,
is it your question? I think you are Aditya, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Aditya, you are asking that from here, as I am saying, I started setting P to the root node, then I have come to here, then I have come to here, then I am coming back here. So how am I, after going to the left, how will I be able to go back to the root node? As we are saying in the linked list representation of the tree, we'll be storing only the left child and the right child in a node. So if the node is containing 7, I'll be only storing the left subtree. So basically the address of this 3 here and address of this 13 here. So how will I be able to, so if I consider this as a 3, let's consider. So how will I be able to set P back to here? So I started P with setting to this node. Then I have set the P to this node, then I have set the P to this node, and then I'm saying that I'll be going back here, then I'll be coming here, then I will be going here, then I'll again be coming back here, will be again coming back here. How will I be able to go back from here to here, or here to here, or here to here? That's a good question, but I want the answer from you guys.
So we are using a recursive function here, right? So we are not we are actually calling the function again with the left subtree as input. So when the function ends, say returns 1 or something, we will come back to this main function where pointer is pointing at 7.
Very good. You are absolutely correct. So exactly. So we, one way of traversing is basically using a recursion. So by recursion, what we can do is we can call the same function with the left pointer, and then the root node will be stored in the memory, in our physical memory. do you know where exactly it is stored in the, I mean, what exactly the data structure that is used for storing the intermediate calls in during a recursive call, of a function?
Stack.
It's a stack. Very nice. So I'll be discussing this. Today I'll be discussing this. Don't worry. So Aditya, please stay for a bit. We'll be discussing this. So again, so I have come to here. So initially I have set P to here, the root node 7. Then I have traversed the whole left subtree. So as you can see, the way this traversal works is I first need to traverse the left subtree. For this whole tree, the left subtree is 365. It is already traversed. By traversed, again, by traversed, it means visiting as well as processing. So thus, the left subtree is traversed. Now what I need to do is I need to process the root data. So that means processing is, as I have said, I will be printing the data. So 7 is printed. Then I need to traverse the right subtree of this whole tree. So basically the left subtree is processed, the root is processed. I need to set the P to here. Now again, for this tree, I need to go to the left subtree P. Now for this tree, I need to go to the left subtree again. As it is a null, I'll be pointing to here, but as it is a null, I'll be going back. So the left subtree of this tree is processed. So I need to process the present root data, which is 11. So 11 is processed. So the left subtree, the root are visited and processed. The remaining is the right subtree. So the right subtree, I'll be setting P2 here. Then left, again it is null. I'll again be setting P2 here. Then 12 will be processed. And then this right subtree of 12, again null. So now for this whole tree, the left subtree is processed. For this tree having 13 as the root, the left subtree containing 11 and 12 are processed. So now we need to process this root data. So that by processing, as I have said, I will be printing the value. So 13 will be getting printed. And then PTR will be, or P will be set to the right subtree here. Then here to the left subtree of this node containing 15. As it is null, I'll be processing this now because the left subtree is processed. So I'll be processing the root data, which is 15 here. Then the right subtree, again it is null. So P will be pointing to here. Now P will be pointing again to here, and again to here. So finally, the traversal will be completed and the order will be 3, 5, 6, 7, 11, 12, 13, 15. Is there any question other than this, the question that Aditya already asked regarding how will we be able to go back from here to here? So is there any other question?
Sir, it will end at root, right? After traversing the whole right subtree?
Right. It will be ending at root. But it actually depends on the way you have implemented it. Of course, we'll be discussing the code. So every time, so as you can see, as I think Priyesh was saying, that we'll be using one recursive function. So by recursive function, what we'll be doing is we'll be starting with the root, then we'll be going to the left subtree, then left subtree and so on, and we'll be coming back again. Then I'll be going to the right subtree and then left subtree and so on and so forth. And we'll be coming back here after traversing the whole left subtree of this total node, total tree, total binary tree. And then I'll be visiting the root node, then I'll be going back to the, going to the right subtree and I'll be processing it again. So after processing, after completion of the traversal of the left subtree, I was coming back to the root node. And then after processing or traversing of the right subtree, the PTR will be pointing, as you can see, I mean, after every, after the completion of every subtree, the pointer is going back to its parents because it's a recursive call. So as, I mean, as we are traversing in the left root right manner, after processing, after the processing is completed for the left, the pointer is going back here, and then we are forcibly putting the traversal in the right subtree. But after the completion of the right subtree as well, the pointer will be again coming back to the root node. Get that?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So can you say what will be the simplest way of writing this in terms of code? In terms of code, in the sense, in terms of a C code?
Sir, if we use recursion, then yeah, like we have the base condition is that if we face the we don't update the pointer to null, the base condition would be that we stand at the pointer and we are just accessing the P arrow on left or P arrow right.
Basically we need to check whether root, so in the diagram that I have wrote, I have used P, so let's use P here. If P not equals to null, I'll be continuing, right?
Yeah.
So if P is equals to null, as you can see, P is starting with this, then here, and so on. So basically, we'll be starting with whether P is null or not. If P is not null, then what we'll be doing is, first we need to go to the left. Right? So I started P setting to the root node. If P is not null, I'll be going to the left. If P is not null, I'll be going to the left. If P is not null, I'll be going to the left. But as P is null, then what should be the thing?
So then I will go back, I will print.
No, first of all, I'll be printing. Exactly. First of all, I'll be printing. So first of all, I'll be printing the P data. But as I am saying, from here I'll be needing to go here. So before printing, so if I am calling this function as say in order, and it is taking say one struct, say BT node that we have earlier defined, containing say the parameter is P. I'll be calling the same function in order with setting what? So first this
P left.
Correct, absolutely correct. So I'll be calling this function with P left.
And sir, in the condition, should mm-hmm. it not be P left not equal to null?
Yeah,
because if yep. it is null, then mm-hmm. I will not go there and I will print the P data, and if it is not null, then I will go for P left.
Okay, so you are suggesting is I'll be checking whether P left is null. If it is null, then I'll be printing, and if it is, yeah, I'll be printing the P data, and if it is not null, I'll be calling this function, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah, that is another way. But in that case, I'll be needing to have if else statement, isn't it? So I'll be checking if P left equals to null. I'll be printing the data.
Sir, not else. Null. I'm saying not equal to null only, but this condition should be P left not equal to null.
Okay, P left not equal to null. Then what I'll be doing? Tell me.
Then I will go for the same thing. In order P left, recursive function I will use. And if it is not the case, I will just print
in order P left. and then print, and then in order. Okay, so the last part I have mentioned is we should be calling this
in order p write.
Anyone having any remarks regarding this?
If you are checking p left not equal to, then you will also have to check p right if not equal to null before calling the in order function.
No, let me tell you one thing. Let me give you another example.
Because we don't have the initial, right? If it is null and we just call the function, then it might
let me just draw one subtree, one tree, small tree, that is containing only A. So the left subtree is containing null, the right subtree is again containing null. So P is pointing to here, right? So P left is equals to null. Then how this printing will be happening?
No, sir, say P left is printing not null, will be outside right this
if condition. It will be outside the bracket of if condition.
Oh, so you are saying that, okay, so let me write it. Okay, so there is a provision of putting text as well. Yes, control shift T. So what you are suggesting is if P left not equals to null, then what I'll be doing is I'll be calling this in order function with P left.
Yes.
Right? And then yes, I'll be printing. Right?
Yes, sir.
Printing the P data.
Yeah.
And then again I'll be, as you are saying, if P write not equals to null, then I'll be going to the right. So you are suggesting this solution.
Yeah.
Can someone point out any issue with this that can happen? So anyone? So there can be some issue with the actual recursive call or the execution of the recursion. Okay, let me argue.
Sir,
we can check this. Please.
Not even the root is null, then we will have an issue.
Okay? If the root is null, we will be having an issue because
in the second statement, print data.
In the second statement, exactly. So if it is say containing null, so everything is null. It's an empty tree. So for an empty tree, so basically, what is happening for an empty tree? The root is containing null, isn't it? And you are pointing, you are initializing P with root, right? Then when you check whether P left equals to nulls, but P itself is null. So there is no way you will be able to check the left of null. It will give you a segmentation fault or a runtime error. Isn't it? You get the point, right?
Yes, sir.
Another issue will be like, since we are writing print statement out of the if loop and the recursion statement is inside the if loop.
Right.
So let's say
exactly. Another thing is, so this statement, so this recursive call, that's exactly what I was saying. It will cause you some problem regarding this recursive call as well. So essentially, the call is getting up, the recursive call is happening from the statement here. You'll be able to get this. Of course, after the completion of this if block, this print statement will be happening. But in the stack, in the actual physical stack, there might be some issue. If we try that, we'll be able to see.
So actually, when the recursion will end, only then we will be able to print, because since let's say the tree is full, like every there is no null node, like every the tree is complete, like every node has two nodes, ABC. So then what will happen while we traverse the tree using this recursion statement, we'll not be able to print the data like 3, 5, 6, 11, we have done that, because it is happening inside this statement. Again, when we calling this in p arrow left, then again the if p left is satisfying, then again it will go in this if loop only. So it will never come to the print statement. After this recursion ends, then only it will come to the print statement.
Did you get that? I mean, others? So Aditya is saying...
Sir, yeah, I got what Aditya said, but that is what the condition, right? I have to traverse the whole left side first, then when I encounter the null, I go back and print. I get so, what Aditya is saying, but that's what I want. Means I got the first problem that if the root is null, this whole thing will be segmentation fault.
Right.
But I don't get why Aditya is saying.
Please, Aditya, go ahead.
Yes, sir. Let's say B is again divided.
Let's draw a tree here. Say A.
Either way, we have to travel the entire left subtree before coming printing the root, right? So.
Right.
That should happen. It's not a problem.
Aditya, you were saying something.
Yes, sir. Let's say B again is split into D and E.
Okay. Here D and E. Okay.
So it's like when here at B, the P left again, it's null. Not null.
Not null. So P will be here.
P left not null. So again, D is something let split it into something else to two node, like it's a big tree. So what will be happening that we are always satisfying this if statement. So it will go deep down into the tree, but it will not be printing anything.
No, but this, I mean, so for example, I presently I am here, then I have come to here. Then I am checking whether the left is null or not null, right?
Yeah.
So every time I am checking that. So as I am saying that P left is not null, I'll be not calling this function. I'll not be calling the same function with again with the left. So presently P is here. So based on this, I am not actually going here, going left subtree of this root of this tree. What I'll be doing is, so basically for that, this statement is over. I mean, this statement will not be executed because P left is actually null for this.
Yes, sir.
Now, the P data will be printed, F will be printed. Then as we are saying, P right is not equals to null. So in this case, P right is also null. So the recursive call will be end. I mean, there will be no further recursive call for this. Then the P will be, so basically the last P was here. So if I, so basically, so this P is now removed. So the left subtree is traversed. The P is presently here and the P left is, so this part is completed. P left not equals to null P left in P left. Now we'll be printing the value of D. So first F was printed, then D was printed. Then I'll be checking whether the right is null or not. So the new P will be here. Then again, the new P will be the left, again null. Coming back to here, G will be printed. Then again, right. There will be no going from here to here. I'll be coming back here. So for this, it is traversed. B, D for this tree. The left subtree of this subtree is the left subtree of this tree is completed. The traversal is completed.
Sir, how did you go from F to D?
F to D.
Yeah.
So
completing the F subtree, then how did you go to D? Go back to D.
So that's exactly what this recursion will be doing, right? So I am calling. So. Is there any way? No, I can do this.
Yes, sir. Now I got it. It's actually right. Yeah.
So as you can see, pardon for my super excited way of trying to make you understand this. So yeah, so what I am doing is, so from here, so this p equals to this recursive call of in left is happening from here, right? So initially p is here. So in the stack, as we are saying, in the stack, the A is stored. When we are going, we are setting P from here to here. Then again B is stored. When we are coming here to here, then again D is stored. When we are coming from here to here, then again F is stored. But for this example, F is not stored because we are not going beyond the left of F. So F is getting printed, and the of course F is traversed and visited. Then one pop operation is happening. So now we have the present P. The P was set to F in the last case when we have traversed F. Now the P will be set again back to the parent of D from where this recursive call has happened. Because as you can see, from this line, in equals to, in bracket P left, this is actually calling the function. When this function call is ending, the statement will be returning back to here with the old P, with the P with which this P left is getting called. The same P is getting returned here by this pop operation. So by this P data, we will be getting the data as D. So by that, by the beauty of recursion, we will be getting back from here to here. Is it clear? I'll be discussing this with an actual example of a stack.
Yeah, after seeing the code.
Okay, so I'll be actually discussing this using an actual stack. So the point is that the point I wanted to make is here, as there are two different condition checks, first of all, it will be a little bit more time consuming. But as you can see, we are not actually considering this extra function call. It will be a limited advantage. But the thing is, based on this, the stack will be looking like, okay, so let me ask you another question. So just whether you know or not. So you have learned about recursion, right? So have you tried writing the non-recursive version of a recursive function? Was it taught in the earlier course, CS3101?
Yes, for
factorial.
For factorial, we did both recursive and non-recursive.
No, for factorial, it's not actually making the non-recursive version out of the recursive version. So factorial, we can actually use, we can actually iteratively use the beauty of iteration to get the result of a factorial. So we are not actually making the corresponding version, the corresponding non-recursive version from a recursive version.
Sir, I think sir taught by the lecture notes, I saw that sir taught in the other way around, means normal function, how it can be modified into a recursive
function. But I am talking about the other way around. Yeah, so basically, so I think you have, in the earlier class, the Tower of Hanoi problem was discussed, right? So Tower of Hanoi, there are three pegs and you have, say, number of dices, and the dice, dice are kind of, it is the largest one, then above that it's the next largest, and at top it is the smallest one. So you need to transfer all the dice from here to here. And the condition is there should not be any dice or any plate, you can say, any plate having a small radius, I mean having a large radius over a smaller radius plate. So we cannot plate, I mean if I consider another peg, I cannot place one bigger plate over a smaller plate. And another condition is, at one time I will be able to transfer only one die, one plate from one plate to the another. So how will we be able to transfer all these three plates from one peg to another, taking one third peg as an auxiliary temporary storage? So I'm sure you have seen the code, which is a recursive version, which is actually a recursive one. For that, there is no iterative version, but the one that you are talking about is the factorial. For the factorial, there are actually two versions. One is recursive, another is iterative. So, but for this, there is no iterative version. To make one non-recursive version out of this, it's basically what you need to do is you need to make your own stack. You need to make your own stack in which this, the thing that is happening inside your memory while this recursive calls are happening, these things you need to implement on your own. So coming back to this thing, so it will be correct, but the thing is, if we try to kind of implement this as a non-recursive version or try to use the use our own stack to implement this, it will be pretty hard. I'll be talking about this today. No, don't worry. Okay, so basically, as I am saying, so just completing the discussion that I started with. So basically, I'll be checking if p not equals to null. So everyone with me, right? It is absolutely correct. So there will be the main issues are, there are two condition checks, and as Aditya was kind of having this confusion that when this function call is ending, whether we will be printing, we will be able to print this statement or not, or we'll be able to get the present data or not. That's not true. We'll be able to do that, but the problem would be if we try to implement the corresponding non-recursive version out of it. It will be problematic, not problematic, but a little bit hard for us to implement that, the corresponding non-recursive version. So it will be this version will be an easier one, where I'll be just calling the inorder function here, as you can understand, of course, with the p write, and that's all. So it will be the simplest one. So if I write this problem, sorry. So as you can, so this tree we have written already. So in the first or second class, I guess, we have written this tree to make the corresponding to display a tree. So let me just compile it and let's look at the output. So as you can see, it is the same tree as this one. So 7, 3, 6, 5, 13, 11, 12 and 15, as you can see, 15, 13, it's basically the 90 degree anti-clockwise rotated version of the same tree. Now, if I write the corresponding recursive version of this inorder traversal, say inorder, and then I need to get a parameter, say struct bt node, then start say p, and I'll be checking if p not equals to null. I'll be calling the same inorder function with p left. I'll be processing the p node, that is, I'll be printing the value, say data stored in p data, and I'll be calling the inorder function with p right. So that's it. So to call this function, what we'll be doing is I'll be just calling inorder. I'll be passing the root of the tree, and that's it. And now if I compile this one and if I make it run, so as you can see, it is, we are getting the same output, the one that we have got here, 3, 5, 6, 7, 11, 12, 13, 15, 3, 5, 6, 7, 11, 12, 13, 15. So this was the function. So do you have any question? Any question on this inorder traversal? All right, then moving ahead. So this was a function that I have written. So for pre-order traversal, so the way the traversal or the visiting of the nodes will be happening is, first we'll be processing the root data. Whenever I am visiting, I'll be first processing the data. And then I'll be traversing the left subtree, and then I'll be traversing the right subtree. Now please help me to get the pre-order traversal of this tree. What will be the pre-order traversal? Anyone? Anyone? I am online, right?
Sir, just we have to, I think, print the p data first, then.
Right. No, I just want to know the order in which the nodes will be processed. That is, the node will be printed.
Print f p data. Then
No. I just want to get the order. The order in which the. So earlier we have seen. Okay. So this was the order. 3, 5, 6, 7, and so on. So what will be the order for this?
7, 7, 3, 6, 5, then 13, 11, 12, 15.
Correct. So this is the root, this is the P. Whenever, as I have said, the first step will be process the root data at any point, or process the current data. So by processing, I'll be printing 7. I'll be coming to the left. Again, this is the root, process the root data. Print 3 will be printed. Then I'll be traversing the left subtree. As there is no left subtree here, I'll be going to the right subtree. So the new P will be here. So process the root data 6, new P here, process the root data 5, new P is left of here, null, right of here, null. So for this tree, 6, 5, this is done, this is done. So basically, this is done, this is done. So I need to go to the right again, which is null as well. So I need to go back to here. So for the whole tree, process the root data done, process traversal of the left subtree done. So I need to go to the right subtree of the whole tree. So this will be the root data. Root data processed, 13 printed, done. P will be here, printing the 11, done. Coming here, null, done. Right, process. So the new root will be 12. 12 is processed, done. So for this tree, root is processed, right subtree, left subtree is traversed. So then we need to go to here. So this will be the P here. And it will be processed, 50, done. And the corresponding function call the implementation would have been like this: void pre-order, sorry, and then struct bt node, so star p. If p not equals to null, so basically the order is just the other way around. So first I'll be printing the data, then I'll be calling this preorder function with the left, and then I'll be calling the post preorder function with the right. Now if I call this, not oops, sorry for that. I need to, so there is some problem with my ID. Sometimes it happens. As you can see, this was a tree. The in-order traversal was 3-5, so we have already seen that. The pre-order traversal is, as we have noted here, 7-3-6-5. 7-3-6-5, 13-11-12-15. 13-11-12-15. Do you have any question? All right. So the third way of traversing a tree is a post order, where the data will be processed at the very end. So first we'll be traversing or visiting and processing the left subtree, then I'll be processing and visiting and processing the right subtree, then only I'll be processing the root data. Now help me to get the corresponding post order traversal for this tree. So the P will be here. What happened? I don't know. Why this part is not coming? That's okay. Yeah, P is here. Now, what will be the order?
5 first.
5 first. Why? Because P from here to here. So basically, traversing, we need to traverse the left subtree. P will be here. Traversing the left subtree, P will be here. Null. Then traversing the right subtree, P will be here. Then traverse the left subtree, P will be here. Then traverse the left subtree, P will be here. Null, P will be here. Null. So now 5 will be getting printed. So 5 done. Or let's just tick it. 5 done. Then for this tree, left subtree is done. Then right subtree is null. That is done. Then we will be printing 6. Done. So for this tree, left is done, right is done. Then it is the root data. Left done, right done. Then we need to process the root data. That is 3. So done. Then, please help me.
Then
12. So basically P will be coming here, then P will be coming here, left subtree null, then P will be here, left, right, both null, then 12 will be printed. Then
11,
15, correct,
15,
then 13,
13, 7,
15, 13. So up to 13, left subtree is done, right subtree is done. That is traversal of left subtree done, traversal of right subtree done. Now I need to process the root, so 7 will be getting printed. The corresponding code, as you can of course already understand that, so basically we need to have this print statement at the very end, and before that we will be just calling the function. So if I so So as you can see, the order is, post order is 5, 6, 3. Let's compare it here. 5, 6, 3, 12, 11, 5, 6, 3, 12, 11, then 15, 13, and 7. 15, 13, and 7. As you can see, it's a pretty easy, the same way. So basically, I'm traversing left first, then right, then I'm just traversing the or processing the root data. For pre-order, I am, whenever I'm visiting one node, I'm processing it. Then I'm visiting the left subtree or traversing the left subtree, and then I'm traversing the right subtree. For in order, I'm first traversing the right, left subtree. Then I am processing the current node, the data, and then I am traversing, that is processing and visiting, visiting and processing the right subtree. All right, do you have any question up to this? All right, so I actually planned on discussing the non-recursive version of this, starting with only the pre-order traversal. For the pre-order traversal, as we have said, we need to first process the left the root data, then traversing the left subtree, and then we'll be traversing the right subtree. But I think it will be a little bit hard for you to concentrate because it's already past 1 hour. So shall we discuss this in the next class, or shall I continue? So let's defer this discussion to the next class. So in the next class, I'll be discussing this non-recursive version, how to get the non-recursive version of this one, of this function, basically by implementing the stack on our own. That's exactly what should be done. Again, I would like to highlight the fact that you have written the non-recursive version of factorial or a Fibonacci sequence, but there, I mean, for those cases, it was the iterative version. And the iterative versions are the non-recursive versions. But for this situation, as you can see, there is no way you can iteratively get this. Can you say why there is no iteration here? Because of the linearity and the sequentiality of the data structures. So earlier for factorial, it was a linear sequence. So we can have kind of a series, which can be stored in an array, which can be traversed line by line or element by element. And in that, as it is a linear data structure way we can represent it, it will be easy for us to get an iterative version. So for I equals to 1 to n, so we'll be able to write the code for getting the factorial of a value, say n, and say I plus plus. And then we'll be needing to, well, you know the thing. So we need to declare one f equals to 1, then it will be f star equals to I. And the corresponding recursive version was, there should be a condition, that is whether the number, say I, is equals to 1 or less than or equals to 1 or not. We'll be only considering the positive numbers. So it will be returning 1, and else it will be calling the same fact function so basically it will be I star, basically return I star f I minus 1. So I hope you can remember this. But as you can see, the non-recursive version is using this kind of linear way we can actually traverse the thing. But that is not the case for a tree, as we have discussed in the beginning. So that's why the non-recursive version in this case will not be implementable using something like this kind of a for loop. What we need to do is we'll be needing to implement this stack on our own, which is handled by our operating system, or not actually operating system, but our C compiler or C executor, which is actually taking care of this stack for us which enables us to write this kind of recursive version of a code. Okay, so do you have any question? Feel free to ask.
So then how you'll be doing that in non-recursive way? You'll be storing the address like in a stack and then...
Right. So basically what I'll be doing is, so I'll be creating one stack. And as I was saying, so every time while processing, I'll be printing, but while visiting, I'll be putting the root data, basically the whole node. So I'll be putting the whole node here. So every time I face one null, I'll be going either in the left direction or the right direction. First I'll be popping it, and then I'll be either going to the left direction or the right direction. So basically for this, just to give you a hint about the next class, so first 7 will be processed, that is 7 will be printed, 7 will be pushed in the stack, then the left subtree of 7 will be 3. It will be again pushed in the stack, 3 will be processed. Then as there is no left subtree here, it will be again popped. So we'll be getting this node, and the left subtree is done. So left subtree traversal is done. We need to get the right subtree. So this right subtree is basically this 6 node, right? And this 6 node will be again pushed here. So it will make this stack look like this. Pardon my amateur is drawing. And while we will be visiting this, we'll be processing it as well. So 6 will be processed. And then the left subtree is again will be pushed here, 5. So 5, as there is no left or right, it will be popped. So 5 will be popped. There is no left, no right. So both left and right are done. So it will be, so then again, the next operation will be again another pop. So for another pop, 6 will be popped. For 6, the left subtree is done, and the right subtree is null, so it is also done. So again, we'll be applying another pop. So the next pop will be resulting in the 7. So for 7, the left subtree is traversed, the right subtree is not traversed. So basically, note that the tree is empty, the stack is empty now. Now what we'll be doing is we'll be pushing the right subtree, which is containing this node 13. We'll be pushing this into the stack. So the new stack will be looking like this, and so on. So we will try to write some codes, and I mean, if you are not understanding this, don't worry. I'll be taking step by step discussion on how to do this.
Sir, just one thing. Why are you popping the 7 when the right subtree is not complete? Because every other case, only after the completion, we are popping it out.
Oh. So basically, what I am doing is, so every time I am...
Not for three.
You
popped it also.
So every time the left subtree is processed, I am popping. So why? Okay. You may ask why. The reason is, I know that the processing of the root is of course done. Processing of the data, then while traversing the left subtree, it is done. So for a node, if we consider a node, so this is containing the data, this part is done and this part is done in the beginning. So this part is done first, this part is done in the second, and now I'll be doing this. So that the thing that that is stored here is actually I'm pushing it into the stack. So there is no point in keeping this one, because the left, as I've said, this part is done, this part is done, and this part I'm currently working on. So that's why, well, there is no point in keeping it in the stack.
And again, we can say that since we have no use of keeping 7, because once left, we are keeping 7. Correct. just to return to that point.
Exactly, like, exactly. So we are keeping 7 just to get back to here, just to get back to the right subtree of 7. So after traversal of this whole subtree, this part is done. So the left part is done, and the processing of the root data is also done. Then I am starting processing this one, or started traversing of this one. Then there is no point in keeping this whole node into the stack. Get it?
Yes, sir.
Great.